It's Endless Ocean. Last time we received an email from Alfred Thorman about checking out the migratory routes of the humble whale shark, and that's exactly what we're going to be doing this update. Whale sharks really are cool animals, and we'll be hearing quite a bit about them later. I think if everybody had the choice of whether to swim or not to swim, they would choose to swim with the whale shark. Just a personal opinion there, though. And we already got some emails about our finds from last time. First is about the red coral. We totally donated that to the museum. And we got a pair of trunks. We definitely didn't sell it to dealers. That would be evil and very Japanese, in fact. And this is about the Anomalocaris fossil we found. And for it, we receive a diving suit. So we got two suits to choose from here, and let's might as well take a look at them. See, this is what we've been wearing, the Dusty Sub suit. This is one of our original suits, the Driftwood suit. And this is one we just got here, the Marine Sunset suit. I don't care for it too much. There we go. Yes, we are using that for today. Now, we need to be in the morning to check out the whale sharks, because there's some time stuff. It's just the game kind of wanting to railroad you into going to certain places at certain times. So let's go over here to the Moea Atoll. It's not pronounced Moai, unfortunately. I thought it was for a bit, but no. The I and the A are wrong order. Really doesn't matter what music we select here, because the second we travel into the new zone we're going into, it will be overrided anyways. Whatever. Whale sharks really are the happiest looking fish. They just have such a doofy, smiley face. Well, let's go check it out. Or touch it. Whatever. Yes, this is the only fish that's big enough to grab. Never before has a fish been grabbable. Or touchable. Not true. So this is the only fish that we can ride in the game. And let's ride that fish to somewhere mysterious. Welcome to the underwater ruins of the Moea Atoll, with quite possibly the least fitting music in the game. Good sounding, but absolutely makes no sense. This has nothing really to do with Amazing Grace whatsoever. It's a bit of a weird partition of the game in general, actually. It's a very large zone. It's a very large temple. There's not necessarily a lot of things you can do within the temple, and there's not necessarily a lot of fish outside the temple. Or even in it, to be for that matter. It's kind of empty-ish. There's a bit of a puzzle element in it, as we will be seeing. There's limited entrances into the temple itself. There's very limited rooms inside the temple. And it's kind of hard to find stuff around here. You spend a lot of time doing what I'm doing right here, just kind of looking around for something to interact with. Just slowly moving around the temple itself. Right now I'm looking for stuff in the sand, because we will be encountering things on occasion down here. Looks like we found a doorway, though. Might as well poke our head in and see what's up. Well, congratulations, everybody. We've encountered the first and only true puzzle in the game. How do we make the air go away? It's a real tricky one. We won't be solving it for a bit. See if you can figure out what we're gonna end up doing before we get around to doing it, though. I guarantee the solution is not what you expect. Let's try going down the side passage. Or not, I guess. Sure. Yeah, this is the other quote-unquote puzzle element for the area. Certain passages have currents that make it so you can't go one direction through it. So we can come from that passage in that area into this room, but we can't go the other way. It basically limits the flow, I guess, through the temple. For now, we're going to continue our circumnavigation of the temple. Just looking for stuff in the sand. There are some fish that we can only find in the sand down here. I don't think we're going to actually find anything, but we can find stuff down here. This is also a good way for us to find the next major entrance of the temple, I suppose. You might note also that we've finished one round, I suppose, of Amazing Grace, which kind of gives you an impression of how much time has passed since we came into this area. It's really big, and there's not a lot in it. You don't encounter a lot of roaming fish. Most of the fish are within the temple itself. And at the same time, it's really just slow moving to look for stuff outside the temple. So it's fine when you're just trying to relax and just swim randomly and see if you can find anything, I suppose. But it gets a bit boring. It gets a bit slow. There is a faster way to get around the temple. It's a bit random, but it does work, but that's more for moving around the top of the temple, though. Looks like we found our second entrance of sorts. As you can see here, there's a few openings. Or mainly more, it's that there's a few archways over a big empty space. And it looks like another bicolor parrotfish. Yeah, you can come with me. You'll be our buddy. And some juvenile bicolors. Interestingly enough, you might notice that it's actually the juvenile bicolor parrotfish that are bicolored. Just kind of how it works sometimes. We give the common names of the juveniles or use the characteristics of the juveniles to form the basis of the names. Sometimes we don't even know for the longest time that they're actually the same fish, so. You keep on cruising, green sea turtle. There's quite a few of these little cubby holes in the temple, and almost all of them are, in fact, zoom spots. I don't think this one is. It's the single one that isn't. Wait a minute. Didn't I just... Maybe there's two. Whatever. These are some Emperor Angelfish. Yep. And the zoom spot has what looks like juvenile angelfish. This is often the case that we'll be finding adults outside a nook with juveniles in it. Though it isn't always the case. Occasionally we'll be finding a bit odder things. That wasn't an otter pun. I wish it was. Because it would be pretty cool if it had otters. Now there is a specific kind of quest-related thing in this area that we need to find. And this is the first one. It's a tablet. Now there are, I believe, 7 of these tablets scattered around the temple in various areas. They're hidden a little bit, not too hard, and kind of have to find them all to advance the plot. Though there certainly are other relics we'll be taking a look at. That was the other passage we almost went through before I decided to go back and look at that tablet. Might as well take a chance now to go up over the temple and see what it's like up top. It's big. It's flat. It's made of rock. That's where we were, where the archways were. And here's a section we weren't before. Looks like the whale shark's in the distance, but we'll be checking him out in a bit. Now this area actually has probably the majority of the fish in the entire zone, just in this little area of passageways right here. Most of the passageways around it are blocked, but there's this area with columns that has a bunch of fish in it, as well as a tablet or two. The camera has a little bit of trouble with these passageways. It just kind of bangs against the walls and tries fitting around with you. And we have found our second tablet. Yes, Parrotfish, interpret this tablet for us. What does it mean? What are the secrets of this tablet? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know you couldn't read. Well, we might as well try the furthest path where we came down first. That looks like a dead end in there. Can't get by. A fish we encountered before. It's a flathead. You can come with us, flathead. You can help us explore. So this is a rather large temple. Realistically speaking, it's very unlikely that an ancient peoples would have done it. In terms of its construction, and given its probably very advanced age, I find it highly unlikely that they hewed the entire thing entirely out of sandstone. More realistically speaking, it's that there was a large sandstone area here, I suppose, with some openings, and then they carved holes or rooms within the overall structure. Ah, it's a sapphire devil, also known as the blue damselfish. It's actually probably the most popular fish for aquariums in the United States. And some green chromis. Big surprise there. Ooh, shiny. A A deity idol fragment? Well, that doesn't sound ominous at all. I hope we don't get cursed. Well, there's another nook in here. Another blocked passageway. Ooh, new sea slug. Willens colored Doris. Striped white. They tend to have very generic common names. It just more describes the sea slugs in this game. Not a lot of the sea slugs have actual common names in real life. They just don't have them. There's so many of them and they're so varied that people just tend to give them scientific names and just refer to them as their scientific name. I think we found Hulkamat's video game girlfriend. Penguins are pretty cool. They are very hard to interact with underwater in the game, though. There's something weird with the highlighting of them where you try to touch them, and I think it's like their hitboxes are actually slightly off-model. That sounds very silly, but it is what it is. Now let's see if we can find that whale shark. But first, let's take a look down here. It seems that there's holes in the roof of the temple. Probably so light can get down. And presumably when this was not underwater, air? Assuming the ancient people here weren't mermaids. And as you can see, there is an underlying structure of the temple that we can see on our map. And we'll be going to all those rooms in a short while. First, let's check out this whale shark. Now, as implied and as I mentioned, whale sharks in the game are in fact large enough where we can ride them. Simply by grabbing onto their back and going for a ride. And that actually has quite a bit of use in this area because, as I said, the temple is quite big. And being able to ride a whale shark around does make travel a bit quicker. The only issue is that his patterns of moving around are it's not always the most convenient thing in the world. And we found Skippy's family. But really, who cares about that? I want to go ride that whale shark. Now, it's not hard to catch up to him if you know where he is. He doesn't travel that fast, normally speaking. But when you do hold on to him, it does seem that he travels quicker, allowing you to get around easier. I don't know if that was a conscious design decision with regards to how big the temple is, so you can use him to move around a bit quicker, or if it's just they wanted to make it look cooler when you're holding on to him. I really don't know. Regardless, it's quite fun. Don't see much doing it, but it's fun. Anyways, I'm gonna tell you about the whale shark. The whale shark, Rhynchodon typus, is the world's largest living fish, and logically the world's largest living shark. They have been observed growing up to 13 meters, 42 feet in length, though there are unconfirmed reports of larger individuals. The whale shark, the only member of its genus and family, has been around on the Earth for at least 60 million years, putting its genesis back to around the extinction of the large sea reptiles. Though perhaps intimidatingly large, the whale shark is a filter feeder that feeds primarily on plankton and small nectens. They're the only one of three known filter feeding sharks alongside the basking and megamouth sharks. While the whale shark has many rows of teeth in its mouth, much like the other more traditional sharks, they are much smaller in size and have no apparent active role in feeding. How it does feed is rather different, especially when compared to the filter-feeding baleen whales. The whale shark feeds by sucking in a mouthful of water, closing its mouth, and then expelling the water through its gills. While the water is expelled, the plankton gets pushed against the modified denticles, the tooth-like scales sharks are covered with, that line its gill plates and pharynx, which filter the food out of the water, which is then swallowed by the shark. That being said, to our surprise, we have observed the whale shark feeding on small schools of fish on occasion. the whale shark can be found in tropical waters across the world. They will aggregate at certain areas depending on the season for spawning and feeding purposes, such as the continental shelf off the west coast of Australia, though they are pretty uniform otherwise during the year. They have an average lifespan of 70 to 100 years, rather good for sharks, though they do not reach sexual maturity until around 30 years of age. While they have hundreds of live born pups at a time when they give birth, whale sharks, like sharks in general, have a very slow reproductive rate, often going years without giving birth. The end result of this is that the International Union for Conservation of Nature has rated the whale shark as vulnerable in the wild, largely as a result of commercial fishing in some parts of Asia. Many countries have been making overt bans against the practice, however, though Taiwan and the Philippines are notable exceptions. Of course, not all human interactions with the whale shark are necessarily exploitive. In traditional Vietnamese culture, the whale shark is worshipped as a deity known as Cát Ong, translating literally to Sir Fish. There are quite a lot of neat informal names for the shark in different communities. In Latin America, it is often known as the Pez Dama or Domino for the white spots on its back. In Kenya, it's called the Papa Shilingi from the belief that God threw shillings upon the shark, which are now its spots. In Madagascar, it's known as the Marokitana, meaning many stars. People really like its spots. I can't blame them. Those spots are cool as hell. The whale shark's docility combined with its massive size and occasional playfulness has made it a favorite of divers across the world. Divers and snorkelers are able to swim around it without any risk or threat to them, with the shark often letting people hitch rides, like in the game. Perhaps they think that we're rather funny-looking remoras. I don't know. There's of course a small risk of getting hit by their tails. The tails are quite big, but otherwise they're just a hoot to be with and really no risk at all. They're not gonna eat you. They don't care. I've never had a chance to dive with a whale shark, though it's probably one of the things I definitely like to do sometime before I meet my unfortunate end. They're just so bloody huge and cool and interesting, both in appearance and niche. I hope someday I'll be able to dive with one. If and when that day comes, I'm sure it'll be a thing that I'll remember for the rest of my life. Whale Shark is a pretty cool dude. Anyways, there is that area with the bottlenose dolphins that we didn't take a look at, so let's go do that. Maybe there are secrets we can find in there. Perhaps something to help with the mysterious puzzle that's confounding us, quote unquote. Because we still have that room full of air that we need to get rid of. The air, that is, not the room. The room will still be there. Just with less air. A lot of fish we've seen before. Of course, the dolphins. Eating them tang. I'm right here trying to see if there's any artifacts or treasures on the ground that I'm missing. There can be some down here, I think. So there's two exits out of this room. There's the one on our right and the one directly opposite of it. Let's try this one first. Or we won't. Again. Currents confound us here as well. This room, however, seems to be too short to have an occurrence, but not too short to have a tablet in it. Funny how that works. So I might as well go into my personal feelings on this area. I think it's a kind of an interesting idea all in all, but it's really kind of empty and dull. If there were a lot more randomized fish just kind of floating around above it or around the temple or even inside the temple, a lot more random fish, it'd be a lot cooler, but this area is pretty empty. It's kind of boring. There's lots of swimming in empty places with fish you've mostly seen before and not a lot to do. They do spice it up during the night and different seasons do change what's in here, as with a lot of places in the ocean, but as is, it's not very interesting. There's not a lot to do. We've seen a lot of the stuff here already. Now, that looks like the room we saw before, and it seems that there's a crack with air bubbling up. How interesting. I wonder what we need to do here. Perhaps we can do something about that air in that room so we can progress forward. Maybe. Whoops. Whoops. But it's okay, we didn't mean it, so it's fine. I wonder how the air stayed in that room given that it was bubbling consistently. Mysterious. And we have a new song now. The song is very weird, as you'll notice, because it has a random, I believe, Polynesian man start talking in the middle of it. So if you all of a sudden hear murmuring in the background, that's not all of a sudden me channeling my non-existent Polynesian ancestors. That's the song, in fact. I was very confused for a while listening to the song. I thought there was, like, I left the TV on once when I was playing it. But no, it is the song. Just giving you some heads up there. And we have another tablet. And this room also has a bunch of treasures in it. Not enough heads to be Orochi. Think that's another, yeah, it's another Stark's Demoiselle. And an inscribed nephrite bit. Nephrite is one of two materials known as jade. It's not the one you typically think in the modern sense of jewelry, but it is known informally as jade. And it has some very unique uses in the classical sense. In ancient cultures in the Eastern Asia areas, China and a lot of the Polynesian islands, it was often used as a tool and as part of ceremonial weapons. It being here would have some relation possibly to the carved tablets. And holy shit, that is a warty frogfish. And I want you to watch him walk. Watch him walk. Yes. Of course, it's not just localized to Asia. It was used in Europe in Neolithic times as well. We found them in the Balkans, for instance, and Poland. Yes, exactly. I agree. I agree entirely. Godzilla! Totally. Anyway, silliness aside, that's basically the temple as a whole. There are some rooms we have yet to go into, and we will be going into them right now, but otherwise, that's really all the temple has to show for itself, for being as massive and colossal and hard to get around as it is. Feels kind of like they could have done more with this. And the second game, in fact, does have other sunken places. Not necessarily like this, or with a similar theme, but it does have sunken, you know, buildings of the ancient sort. And they do a lot more interesting things with them, as I understand. So, maybe they learned from this part. Who knows? Maybe they just ran out of fish to put here, or maybe summer in-game is the worst season for this place. It's really hard to quantify it and make, you know, total sure that it's just a seasonal fuck-up, or July is horrible in-game or something. I don't know. I'm just gonna say that more likely it's just a very, very... I won't say that they were lazy with it, because it is very nice to look at. I think they were going for something with the atmosphere of emptiness and how it spread out that they didn't actually accomplish, I think. I think it made it kind of dull from a both a gameplay perspective and a relaxing perspective, because just swimming in straight lines where it's entirely empty, it's not that interesting in-game. In real life, it might be fun. It certainly is enjoyable just to swim underwater, even if you don't see much. But in-game, you don't have the enjoyment of the physical exertion. Anyways, this room right here is, in fact, the only way to get into the majority of the temple. Right in that columnar area we were before. There's a couple paths here. We'll be going one way during this dive. You could go straight here, or you can take a right. I think we're gonna go and take a right. Yeah. Now there is a fish in here that I must warn you, it is somewhat disturbing. Oh god, there he is. That's the Asian sheep's head, Ras. He is one ugly looking dude. Ugh. Cool fish. He's very cool looking, but he is ugly. An interesting thing about his scientific name, it's the reticulated half coccyphus. Now, coccyphus isn't actually anything as far as me and Chirokojo can tell. It's apparently a Greek term for a dark unknown fish. So it's a reticulate half one of those. Whatever. Into the row of rooms that we can see on the map. And there you can see also the holes in the roof where we saw the sun coming through earlier. Now this room looks very empty and kind of dull. And it is. But we will be coming back to this room later, possibly, and there will be things in this room that appear relative to a certain item we find. It's kind of a silly thing for them to do, but yeah. That will come in the distant future, though. Just before we end this game. And we found another tablet. We're almost done. I believe we have one left. A sea chart. Well, that's not that surprising, I suppose. If there's one thing that the Polynesian people are known for, it is being extremely good sea navigators. They were capable of traveling the ocean in basically large open canoes with high precision, moving from island to island across colossal distances. And inclement weather and multiple seasons, it's really phenomenal how skilled they were at it, how good their tradition, their oral tradition of the techniques that they passed down. They were astounding navigators. That's why they were actually able to have, not too uncommonly, people travel massive distances. Like, it's not that infrequently that there was travel between, say, Polynesia proper and, say, Hawaii, which is a very big distance. Wasn't daily, just because there was really no point to it, but it happened not too infrequently. It ended up having a major effect overall on the development of the culture of the Hawaiian Islands, and particularly their religions. Now we are back in the room that used to have that air bubble. And there's only one tablet left in the entire temple. But I think we're going to save that for the second dive here, which we're going to do in a few minutes, basically. We're just going to pop up top, then pop down again. We're basically going to knock this out as quick as possible. I don't mind the temple while doing it, say, in my own time, just having fun, you know, chilling out, but it does kind of get to you. It's just a bit of a flub by Erica. So we found an entire ancient temple underwater. It was pretty amazing. You think they would have noticed that via satellite, but nobody bothered to look. Or boat over there, apparently. There are quite a few things we can find there to help us learn more about the ancient culture that was here. But some of it, we have to actually find treasures elsewhere in order to unlock them, which is kind of weird. And we will be getting most of the important stuff in due time. Ha! Academics. Fuck 'em. Wait, I'm kind of an academic. Yes, we won't mind you. I think we're all very well tired of your garbage. Now, we wouldn't be having this talk if we hadn't found those nephrite bits. The nephrite bits allow us to decipher, quote-unquote, the monuments there. Though it's more that we're going to be emailing the inscriptions to someone else. Well, that was spooky. Any ghosts on our bow? Ancient Polynesian ghost god things? No? Well, I guess we're okay for now. Let's go check our email. I hope ghosts can't send emails. That would be weird. I can click it. Apparently, ghosts can send emails. Well, let's read our other stuff first. We still can't rule out the possibility that the remains you found on the ocean floor are natural formations. Well, I think that's a little disingenuous, simplifying the whole question about the natural formations in Yonaguni. I'll address that, but first I want to finish these emails. We have the location info for Moaea Atoll. They only talk about the atoll outside it, kind of. They don't actually talk about the temple inside. We don't get email for that, because we are the only ones who have discovered it. It is so mysterious that we don't even get an email about it. Now, since we found those nephrite bits, Mr. Gregor Mueller, another German fellow, will be helping us with the translations, and once we find all the stone tablets, he will in fact email us their translations. Anyways, back down again. This time with Skippy with us, even though he ain't gonna do shit. Because we have another tablet to find, the last tablet to find. So that means going back into the temple and taking the path we didn't take. Really, we could have done it all in one dive if we wanted to, but then some of that dialogue would have been kind of weird. They don't expect you to find them all at one time. It's not that it's really hidden, so much as maybe they expect you to get bored before finding all of them. Which is a bit depressing, I suppose, but there's a lot of weird things in this game that both overestimate and underestimate how much time you'll spend on a single dive. The entire air system, for example. They give you a ton of air in your tanks, and you're never going to use it all. Just never. The second game does do something with that that's quite interesting, but that's for later. Now, Alfred Thorman made a comparison between this temple and the Yonaguni Monument off of Japan. Now, the Yonaguni Monument is somewhat similar to this in that it has a lot of rough geometric shapes in a large rock formation. People like to think that that means that it was entirely constructed by man. On the other hand, it is in the middle of the sea, and it would have happened, say, during the last ice age 10,000 years ago. And the entire crux of the argument that it is artificially made is that, one, there's a couple holes on top of the rocks that are roughly circular in shape, and two, that there's a lot of straight lines. Now, the stupid part about it is that a lot of rocks have in their structure, in their atomic structure, a geometric kind of shape, and has a lot to effects on how they shear. And a lot of rocks are very capable and do quite frequently shear in straight lines, even vertically straight lines, even at angles. And given that Japan, and in particular the location of that monument, tends to be very earthquake active, it's not surprising that you would have cracks that would form in straight lines. How mysterious. Now, here we have clearly archways and decorations. And as you can see here, we see stacked, you know, bricks of sort. It's really not the same thing at all. And of course, there's a lot of cases like this where people like to interpret for various reasons, nationalism, blatant insanity, that natural formations are in fact artificial structures created by man. The Giant's Causeway is a good example, a bunch of basalt columns in Ireland that are very regular and they have neat geometric shapes. It's definitely not man-made at all, but people like to think weird things, and there's an associated legend with it. The Bimini Road is another good example off of the North Bimini Island in the Bahamas. There's a bunch of fairly regular, roughly rectangular limestone blocks leading out into the middle of the ocean. And to some people, that means it's leading to Atlantis, or Hitler's alien UFO base, or Mu, or something weird that makes absolutely no fucking sense, because we have satellites, and we can see underwater. And if we can tell that there's nothing there, generally speaking. Why would someone build a road that size in the middle of the ocean anyways? It's just stupid. But people will interpret things for their own reasons, be it psychosis or whatever. But it is a bit disingenuous to compare it to this, because obviously it was an inspiration for this temple, seeing as how this is mostly rock that probably was not constructed, but there are natural characteristics here. And I suppose the Yonaguni temple could have been used as a structure by some people. They could have carved some holes in the top and put a tent in the top, I guess, you know. But that's not really the same thing as going, ah, yes, straight lines, that means it's harvested. No, it's not. And that's really all we have to say and find down here in our rather empty temple. We've hit all the hot spots that we can hit right now. We've seen really everything that can be seen. We can come back at night, but we're gonna do that later. I'm quite tired of this place. I'm sure you are as well. And we found a slug, not a fish. Way to go, game. I hope you guys are raring for the strongest character drama that's ever happened in video game history. Hey. Yes. Right. Everybody has a porpoise. Mine is Skippy. Kind of a dick, but he's the only porpoise I got. A little bit. Just a little. For what it's worth, the second game has much better written people you interact with, and they're actually cool and actually do things to help you. And did she just, like, get some guy to put that polar bear there when we were talking with her? This is entirely a ruse, isn't it? Maybe Red's right. Anyways, we have emails about all the tablets we found, so I hope you're ready for some hardcore reading action. Because we're gonna read our digital fake emails. I do. I like this guy. I am down with the love and science, don't you? So apparently the script on these monuments remind him of the language from the Rapa Nui people of Easter Island. Easter Island being, of course, the island off the coast of Chile where they have the Easter Island Moai heads. Which is basically the furthest extent and range of Polynesian peoples in the Pacific, from the ancient times anyways. It's incredible to think that they crossed the entirety of the Pacific Ocean to get to Easter Island. That's a massive distance, and they did it in ancient times. Really, like I said, their navigation techniques were simply phenomenal. 5,000 and 10,000 years ago. Another reference to the Yonaguni thing. Of course they'd say that age because during the last major ice age, which is in that rough vicinity, a little later than that, but roughly in that, the sea levels were much lower than they are now due to a lot of the water being caught up in sea ice and glaciers. So with that, it'd be very possible that they could have built a temple below the current sea level. A triangular extra continent. Well, clearly that's a reference to Mu or Lemuria, one of the lost continents that supposedly could have existed, but mostly was made up by dudes in the 1800s. And of course, there are analogs in a lot of ancient cultures, but it's mostly just conspiracy crap. There probably was not any sort of lost continent by any means. Of course, it's probably just the authors having a little bit of fun, and that's perfectly fine. In any case, that wraps it up for this update. Next time, we're going to be checking out a forest of the underwater variety. See you then.